WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy's born in hot damn Mississippi, surrounded by four walls that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Every Friday here on 1010 WOLB from 10 to 12 is the Frank Conaway Senior NL Show with co-host attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore and beyond. I am Tehma Smith Wilson. It's great to join you on another Friday. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, to purchase your ground rent, or to update your will or your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation but are not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or your comment to 667-334-7242. And last but not least, if you missed the broadcast, please feel free to check us out on YouTube. All you have to do is go to YouTube and type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up, and you can listen to them on your phone, your computer, or your television, and you can share them with others.
All righty. And our other co-host that I call the Dean, Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. Glad to be with you another Friday morning. I'm a procurement lawyer, and I do my best to make this a better place. 410-547-8820 if you want to give me a call.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA, specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangement seminars, veteran benefits. Veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody need to get some insurance, or you might need to look at your insurance and increase it. A couple memorial announcements, or just letting you know we've lost some well-known Baltimoreans here in the last week or so. One is the owner of the Blue Caribbean up on Park Heights Avenue, Brother Terrence, who passed away the other day. Nice guy, nice guy. Loved the Caribbean community. Was a part of the Caribbean Carnival committee. And he will be sorely missed. And when we get those arrangements, we'll let you know. Another gentleman, a pastor, the former pastor of St. Abraham Baptist Church, Reverend Clarence Yerby, went on with the ancestors. I've been knowing Reverend Yerby since I was a teenager. And a lot of people who may not have known him, you may know his daughter, Pam Yerby, who is one of the finest gospel soloists, not only in this city, but probably around the country. I remember back during the day when Kentucky Fried Chicken used to have a gospel contest between Baltimore and Washington. And I had the honor of emceeing the auditions on this end. And the late Andrew Rowe would do the auditions in D.C., and whoever won for Baltimore and D.C. would all meet at the Kennedy Center to decide who would be the winner. And that particular year, Pam won. So our hearts go out to them. I understand the arrangements are next Friday. He will be on view at his church, St. Abraham Baptist Church, in 1100 block of West North Avenue. And the services on that Saturday, I think 10:30 wake, 11:30 funeral, at the Cornerstone Church of Christ up on Park Heights Avenue. And finally, I just got a shock. I didn't even know this person had passed. I just looked in at some papers. And Bob, I know you must have known this guy. He used to be my attorney. And I'm talking about Bill Dorsey. I had no idea Bill had passed. I was at our convention and ran into a mutual friend of ours who told me that Bill had had a fall and that he was in a facility, mm-hmm. Recuperating. But seems that Bill passed on the 17th at the Complete Care and Multi Medical Center in Towson. Bill was the first African-American administrative clerk of the Baltimore District Court. I remember when he went and got his law degree and went into practice. His office has always remained right down on Hilton and Liberty Heights,
mm-hmm.
right there. So our hearts and minds go out to his wife, Betty, and his daughters and the rest of the family. And I understand that the memorial service will be tomorrow at 10 a.m. at St. Cecilia's Catholic Church down on Windsor Avenue. Great guy. Just really has really shocked me. Okay. Now we have a special guest. Bob, you going to introduce our guest?
I will, yes.
Okay.
All right. Joining us today is someone who you probably have heard her name for a long time. She is a special secretary, appointment secretary to Governor Westmore. But before having her come on and inform all of us about what that actually entails in terms of duties, let me give you a little bit of a background for those who may not know Tisha Edwards. For 20-plus years, Tisha has combined the reach of public service and agility of the private sector to ensure all families have access to the resources and opportunities they need to succeed. Across government and corporate leadership roles, she has fused public policy, programmatic innovation, and community engagement to remove the racial inequities that historically have prevented black and brown families, and youth in particular, from fulfilling their potential. In roles spanning from the interim CEO of Baltimore City Public Schools, chief of staff, to the mayor of Baltimore, president of Bridge Education, and executive director of the mayor's Office of Children and Family Services, Tisha has grown organizations, restructured systems for maximum impact, and managed multi-million-dollar budgets. In the fall of 2021, she left City Hall to serve as chief of staff to the Maryland gubernatorial campaign of Westmore, who ran on a pledge to ensure an equal opportunity at success for all Maryland families. After winning the election, Governor Moore named Edwards his secretary of appointments, and she now leads the work of making appointments to Maryland's 600 boards and commissions, all while advancing the Moore-Miller administration's mandate to expand representatives in state government and to leave no one in Maryland behind. Tish, good morning, and I'm happy that you're able to join us.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me, Bob.
All right. And as I indicated, we want to know what goes on in the role, in your role as the appointment secretary to Governor Moore, particularly what the process is for identifying individuals to serve in the various boards and commissions, what openings there were initially to be filled, and the process that you and Governor Moore went through to identify the right individuals for the right jobs.
Wow. So, you know, we've been working really hard on behalf of Governor Moore in the appointments office. I think the thing that was really interesting to myself and to Governor Moore is that when we took this job day one, Bob, across the state, most of the appointments had been predominantly white male, and most of those appointments were coming out of Baltimore County and Annapolis. And the state is much more diverse than that. So the first thing that Governor Moore asked me to do was to initiate an appointments process that would produce excellence and equity, and that would allow us to have folks appointed to these very important boards and commissions that were much, much more representative of the state. And so that's what we've been doing for the past 7 months. We've received thousands of applications, which is wonderful. Highly qualified individuals have raised their hand to be in service of the state of Maryland, which is wonderful. And we've had the opportunity to put folks on boards and commissions that handle extraordinary important issues for our state, education, health care. You name it, Bob, there's a board for it. There are over 600 boards and commissions in our state. So there's lots of opportunity for folks to serve. And I'm excited that we're turning the page in state government and bringing a lot more diversity to these important positions.
Did you encounter any resistance from incumbents in those roles? Because it seems to me that the process that you've identified for achieving diversity reflects the lack of it, perhaps, from the prior administration. And I'm sure that there are policies and people left over that didn't particularly appreciate this new approach. Did you run into that?
You can't see me smiling. You always have the right question to ask, right? So I will say this. Gubernatorial appointments are at the pleasure of the governor. Okay, so I have to remind people that in my job. But 99.9% of the folks who were not reappointed were super gracious. They understood that appointments are at the pleasure of the governor. They understood that our governor came in with a mandate to make our boards and commissions much more representative. And, you know, I don't want to, you know, discount their service to the state, because those folks, whoever they are, they did a great job, and we are super appreciative and grateful, but we did need to turn the page, and we did need to create a new, you know, I tell people we're not creating a new chapter, we're writing a new book. I take that very, very seriously on behalf of our governor and our lieutenant governor. And so most people, Bob, were super, super, super gracious. But of course, there were those, you know, isolated incidents where folks said, well, I want to serve this governor, and why? And sometimes it's not that your service before wasn't great. It's just, again, it's time to move forward and pass the baton. So there were a couple of hard conversations, but overall, the governor has received extraordinary support. People understand, because he's clear. The job is what the, as he tells me, Secretary Edwards, you know the assignment. And so I know the assignment, and I'm comfortable communicating that to others. But for the most part, folks have been super, super, super gracious. But every now and then I got someone that said, wait, what? Why not? And so we have to be really respectful in those conversations. And as I said, acknowledge all the work that folks have done. But the people of Maryland have asked for a leave no one behind agenda. And I am very, very committed as our secretary to making sure that we do that.
One more question before I invite my co-host here to jump in and with questions or comments. Was there anybody that was either excluded or included solely on the basis of political party affiliation?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. This is not, leaving no one behind is not about exclusion. It's about inclusivity. And that's what everybody needs to really understand. We make appointments that are both Republican and Democrat. I mean, and in many cases, statute requires that. So party affiliation is not the driver to the appointments process. It's actually your capacity, your expertise, who you and what you are bringing to the conversation. And so, no, we don't start with party affiliation. This governor really wants to be a bipartisan governor. And again, in order for us to have the best policies possible, we need everybody at the table. So we work very, very hard not to be exclusive, but to be very inclusive.
Okay.
Hi, Ms. Edwards. How are you doing today? Thanks for joining us.
Yeah.
Can you give our listeners some examples of the entities or the corporations that appointments might be assigned to and the industry that they fulfill? I know personally I'm on the Medco board, and not too many people are familiar with Medco or what they do, but I know that there's a lot of other industries and a lot of other boards throughout the state of Maryland that receives appointments.
So thank you for asking that question, and you're 100% right. One of the things that I'm really working on is making sure that we do much more in terms of making folks aware of all of the boards that are available. On our website at govappointments.maryland.gov, there's a full listing, and as I said, there are over 600 of them, and they span every topic imaginable. We have the 911 board. We have the Agricultural Commission. Of course, we have the Maryland State Board of Education. We have the Contract Appeals Board, which I know somebody on this call is very excited about. We have the Professional Standards Teacher Education Board. You know, we even do the judicial nomination process, which I'm super excited about. We're in the process of pulling together all of these commissions across the state who will determine who is going to be on our judiciary for the state of Maryland. The governor considers this to be a huge legacy moment for him. We have a transportation commission. So you name it, I got it. And what's great about that is, again, it speaks to inclusivity. There's something for everyone. And if you have the expertise, now you got to have the expertise, and this is something we take very, very seriously. And so we do a lot of screening, a lot of vetting, a lot of interviewing, a lot of considerations for this. These are very serious opportunities. But if you have the expertise in any elder care, you name it, we have a board, a commission, or a task force. And there's just huge opportunities to serve. But you named it. I have a lot of work to do to make sure that we more broadly advertise and make people aware of the fact that there are so many opportunities to get involved.
And how does someone who is interested in being a part of a board, commission, or task force kind of submit themselves? Do you have to know someone who knows someone, or can you go online and submit yourself to a board or a commission and include your resume and be taken into consideration?
You're 100% on it. This is not a know someone to know someone to know someone. This is about knowing your work and raising your hand. The first thing that we did in our administration on behalf of Governor Moore and Lieutenant Governor Miller is that we created a application portal that is open to anyone. It's very important to me that we be accessible to folks. I don't know everybody. You don't know everybody. And so in order for us to get to equity, in order for us to get to representativeness, we have to be accessible first. And so we do have a portal. You can go to our website, govappointments.maryland.gov, and anyone can apply. And I have an amazing team who all day, every day, they're screening applications, they're reviewing resumes, they're matching people to boards where they have the strongest amount of expertise, and we're doing it through a diversity and equity lens. It's fine for people to recommend folks. We also have a link that if you have a colleague who is also interested, say, in women's issues, and you want to vouch for that person, that's wonderful. They need to submit their application, and you then go on the website and can submit a recommendation, which we do take into consideration. But we have lots of cases where I call people and I say, hey, you submitted an application to be on one of our boards and commissions, and we'd love for you to get involved. And oftentimes that person says, me? I never thought anybody would have looked at my application. I just submitted it because somebody at my church mentioned it to me, or somebody at my job mentioned it to me, but I didn't think anybody was actually going to look at it. I said, no, we look at these applications and we take it very seriously. So it doesn't hurt to get recommendations and references. That's great. But it's not required that you be in the know or be in the click, if you will, in order to be able to appoint it. This governor wants highly qualified individuals joining us in state service through boards and commissions.
And a term that we may or may not hear frequently, but is thrown out, and I know a lot of people may not know exactly what it is, but what are green bag appointments?
I love that. So green bag is a historical reference. It is because the Secretary of Appointment historically and traditionally kicks off the appointments process for those Senate confirmable boards through a green bag. So I actually go to the General Assembly. I stand next to our Senate President Bill Ferguson, and I deliver appointments in a green bag, literally a green bag. And we, for 5 or 6 weeks during session, every week, deliver appointments. Last year, we had over 900 appointments in the 2023 session. And as I said, the green bag is the day that we kick that off, and we do it every week. And through this green bag, what we call the green bag appointments process, and it is for those boards. We have about 190 boards that require Senate confirmation. And so those come through the green bag appointment process. But we also have another 500 or so boards that we are appointing to all year long outside of session that do not have to be Senate confirmed but are equally as important to the appointments process. But we every year, we're excited about the green bag. Starting in November, we start gearing up for green bag appointments, and that's when folks have to come down to Annapolis. They present to the Executive Nominations Committee. They're vetted through the Executive Nominations Committee, and they have to actually be approved by that committee in order to receive a gubernatorial appointment.
And I personally would like to encourage, like you said, anyone who has a special expertise to definitely apply, because not only is diversity trying to be included in the various boards, commission, and task force, but also when you are accepted onto one of these boards or commissions, you meet other people from other counties throughout the state of Maryland. So even though you might be an expertise of what's going on with your particular interest in Baltimore City, it's also good to know how other people are working with the same circumstances or the same situations in other counties throughout the state of Maryland. So it's good to, you know, get additional exposure to what's going on throughout the entire state and to hear from a diverse community of people with your same expertise on your subject matter.
You know, you're 100% right. I want to tell you a funny story. When Governor Moore asked me to be his secretary of appointment, I said, What are you talking about? And I didn't have a real strong point of reference, you know, and I'm as Bob said, I'm a person who's done a lot of work in public service, and I didn't really understand the value, the importance, not only to the state, but even to my own personal profile in terms of like how important these appointments are. So I said to him, wait, what are you talking about? Why is that the job you want me to have? And he talked about, we've got to rebuild government and we've got to get folks in these seats that have not had this opportunity. It's good for the state and it's good for them personally to grow their network, to grow their profile. It's the pathway to federal appointments, right? And I didn't really understand the value of these statewide appointments. So I called my mother. I'm originally from Meridian, Mississippi. Bob knows that about me. I owe him some chicken and dumplings.
And red velvet.
From red velvet cake. Mm-hmm. But I'm originally from Meridian, Mississippi, and I'm a first-generation college graduate. So that tells you about my family. So I call my mother, and I say, hey, Mom, guess what? Governor Wes Moore wants me to be his secretary of appointment. And she said, what the hell is that?
That's the same thing I said.
She said, girl, you have a law degree. Why the hell does he need a secretary? And why can't somebody else make his damn appointment? That really sums up why this is so important and why I'm so grateful that you all understand the importance of this role, because so many of our people, so many of our community doesn't understand how things get done. And we often say the system did this, the system did that. And I find myself asking prior to this job, who is the system? Who is the they? Well, guess what who the they is? The they is all of these individuals who have historically sat on these boards and commissions and made decisions about our community. I have the pleasure, the honor, and the privilege to curate and to bring forward the new they. They is me. They is you. They is us. And that creates a new opportunity for new policies, a new agenda, a new perspective, so that in generations to come, our children will see and understand that not they, we are the individuals who have sat on these boards and commissions and rallied behind our governor, because that a gubernatorial appointment means that you are coming to this board and commission sanctioned, approved, and vetted by Governor Wes Moore, the first black governor in the state of Maryland. And you are pledging to bring forward a perspective from this administration. So it's a huge, huge, huge opportunity. And I'm, as I said, very grateful that you all understand that this is a game-changing opportunity for our community. And we need to make sure that folks know about it. We need to make sure that we're accessible, that people can go on that website, they can raise their hand, and that they can join the they, who are often making decisions on behalf of our community.
Ms. Edwards, this is Carlton C. Douglas here, and please remember that name or you might see or hear it again. First of all, I want to applaud you for being in that position, because for many years, even on this show when our late founder, Frank Conaway, was alive, we talked about the fact of many of the commissions, the paid commissions, not having people that look like us. And many of the boards that should have more diversity in it, not having the diversity that it should have. And I am so grateful that you called today, because I know my name has been placed in on something, but I think it went to the wrong place. And I'm going to, you know, through the help of my good friend and my co-host over here, Bob Dashiell, we're going to try to get it to the right place.
To
be looked at. But tell us, how many of the commissions and boards, I don't know about the boards, but I know there are some commissions that if you are placed on a commission, you get a stipend or you're paid for being there. I don't know about the boards, but can you tell us about how many of these commissions and boards, if you are appointed by the governor, that you do get paid or stipend for being there?
Yeah, they're very few, actually. Out of the 600 in boards and commissions, it's probably less than 20. So it's very few. Compensation is very modest. When there is a compensation to a commission, a lot of times there, you know, with every dollar comes, you know, 10 hours of work. So it is, you know, when there is compensation or stipend of some or some sort, there is some degree of, like, you know, mandatory engagement. And then sometimes it's a full time, you know, it's a full time job appointment that does happen. But, if you use it as an example, it's the Maryland Automobile Insurance Fund. That is a paid board, and it pays $18,000 a year. There are some pretty rigorous requirements to be on that board. You know, you have to have industry experience. There's a lot of vetting that's associated with it. And then there's a requirement for a level of participation and engagement. So there are a handful of paid boards. It is really, really, really the super minority. And it is a handful of boards that require an extraordinary amount of scrutiny because there is compensation associated. But they do exist. But I will also say this to you, and this is the thing I didn't understand, that a lot of times boards and commissions, as I said, most of them not being paid, but definitely lift your profile and can be the pathway to other professional opportunities. And so I encourage folks, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with being a part of kind of that small community of paid boards. They exist. They come out of my office. We appoint to them. But there are so many boards like Medco and others that getting on those boards, they help you professionally with your own network, your business, and they are the skyline to other boards like paid private sector boards. When you are being screened to go into the private community to be on those boards for corporations, they want to see your service at the state level. And those boards can help build your profile way outside of state government. So this is the thing, again, that I didn't understand, how you can not only give back to your community, give to this governor, give to the state of Maryland, for sure, but you also have the opportunity to build your business profile for things way outside of state government that do have a much more monetary compensation perspective in the long term. So, it really just depends. And I have to give a shout out to Sanchelle Roberts' daughter, who was appointed by this governor as the first African-American and the first African-American woman to serve on the Contract Appeals Board. Now, that is a full-time job. She's being paid. She's an attorney. She is by far one of the most qualified individuals who applied for that role, but it is a paid appointment, but it is a full-time job. And she did have to bring a lot of expertise to get to that historical appointment. So they do exist, but there is a very strong vetting process. And I'm very proud to have been the Secretary of Appointments to bring Sanchel to the Contract Appeals Board as the first African-American woman, and my soror, by the way, of Delta Sigma Theta sorority to serve on that board.
Good old DST. Ms. Edwards, do you have some time to remain with us a little bit? Because we might have some callers that might have some questions for you.
I would love to.
Okay, now if you want to call in for questions for Mrs. Edwards, the number to call is 410-481-1010. I'm opening the lines up now, 410-481-1010. Before we go to the lines, either one of you have any more?
I'm still waiting on my chicken and dumplings. That's all I
Well, I tell you what, when you get yours, I want a pan too. It's hard to find people making chicken and dumplings anymore. I'm telling you that now. Did you hear that, Ms. Edwards?
I did. I have to. My update is I've got a mean collard green.
Oh.
Y'all need to be eating more vegetables. I'm trying to and get folks to eating my collard greens.
All right. Well, we'll have the collard greens with the chicken and dumplings now. You know, we'll do both.
I do have something slightly more substantive. You mentioned the judicial nominating commissions, and it brought to mind an issue that I've sort of been talking about for the last 3 or 4 years. You know, many years ago, the members of the Black Bar pushed for a provision that required mandatory retirement of judges at age 70. And that has been the Maryland law for quite a few years now. And it was pushed back in the day as a means of creating openings, quite frankly, for members of the African-American bar to get seats on the various district and circuit courts throughout the state, as well as now the Supreme Court and the appellate court. However, what has occurred to me in recent times is that it's had some unintended consequences. The unintended consequence is that for those attorneys such as myself who have been essentially sole practitioners for most of the 50 years of my career, and who have managed to get through the many obstacles and to survive both financially and professionally, we now reach a point in our lives where we have accumulated a great deal of experience in various areas of the law, but are not eligible anymore to serve, because I mean, most people don't know it, but I'm actually over 70. There are many lawyers, particularly Black lawyers, in and around and throughout the state of Maryland, who are in the same position, who have years and years and years of experience, in either in general practice or in specific areas, who now have time and who can afford to take judicial appointments, who are no longer eligible because of age. If a bill is introduced to modify that provision or in some way, is that something that you've heard any discussion about or consideration of it by Governor Moore?
So, Bob, you know, this is so interesting that you bring this up. I have not been privy to any changes to legislation about the age requirements for the judiciary. However, what you are talking about is something, quite honestly, that I've been thinking a lot about, is this overall issue of access and opportunity and when it happens for Black people.
Mm-hmm.
Right. What I mean by that, Bob, is, you know, I went to University of Maryland Law School. It cost me $135,000 of my money to do that. And, you know, I had extraordinary student loans coming out of law school, and it took a very, very long time and a lot of sacrifice to pay those loans off.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been thinking about this judicial nominations process. I have been working through a lot of times, many, many black lawyers have my same story, your same story, that when we get out of law school, we have a lot of debt. And we got to take care of ourselves and we got to take care of our families. We don't have the resources out the gate to go into a judicial position, and judges are not paid a lot. They're actually paid below market value based on their experience. You don't become a judge to get rich.
Right.
You become a judge to have impact. And so it's very hard to do that in the early stages of your career for many people of color and women, or people who just are not coming from a family where there's been wealth. And so we spend a lot of time when we get out of law school working our way through that, working through the debt, getting ourselves situated professionally, getting our families through and paying for their education. And then you look up and Bob, you're exactly right. You're nearing that point where you're towards the end of the career. You've done all the right things. You're now in a position to take that pay cut. You're now, your family's okay. Your daughter's on the contract appeals board. And you're now in a position financially and from a professional perspective to be a judge. And damn it, here's that age requirement. And that happens a lot, all over the place, because it takes, you know, because it, mm-hmm. we need a way because of structural racism and issues that have kept us from being able to propel forward. So, you know, the short answer, Bob, is no, I have not heard of changing those age requirements. But I agree with you, and it's not just at the judiciary. It's in a lot of these, even state positions, where we have a lot of folks out there who would love to join the state and come and work for Governor Westmore, but they're going to take a serious pay cut because state is a entity that is a government, and government doesn't always pay the highest salary. So I've been thinking about this a lot, Bob, and I may not be able to help your situation, but I am trying to think about how do we get some of these great young, wonderful attorneys who are coming out of law school, who are early in their careers, doing some great work. How do we attract them to the bench earlier? But the challenge they always say to us is, I have a lot of debt and I have a lot of family obligations, and I don't know if I can do this right now. I need some money. And you can't hold that against folks. But you raise an important point about how do we get the right people at the right time serving on our judiciary, and I think it's something that we need to continue to work on.
Yeah. Well, okay. What would it take to change the age limits throughout the state for certain arenas? I know that may not be something that can be done immediately, but what would that process be, or what would that take?
I think that's a legislative process. If I'm not mistaken, and I'm sorry, I cannot remember the name of the body, and Bob might know better than I do. There was a recent task force around figuring out how to expand opportunity in the judiciary. It's the basis of Governor Moore's executive order calling for more diversity on the judiciary. But I think it starts legislatively. It's not something that the governor can do unilaterally. We have judiciary. Committees in the General Assembly, and those judicial committees would need to come together and take action to determine whether or not that's the right thing to do.
Okay, we got about 13 minutes, and we got some folk on the phone. I'm getting ready to come to you in this order. Leo, Don, Carlos, Smitty, we got a line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010, and we have with us a special guest today, Ms. Tisha Edwards, which is the Chief Secretary of Appointments to Boards and Commissions here for the state of Maryland, appointed by our very first African-American Governor, Westmore. Now, when I come to you, If you got a question, let's get it in. If you get ready to talk about somebody else, I'm going to put you on hold. We'll get back to you because we're getting ready going through the second hour where a whole lot of stuff going to come up. So we're going to start with Leo. Leo, you got a question for Ms. Edwards.
Good morning, everyone. I'll hold. I have some announcements to make.
Okay, put you on hold. Hold on. Leo, call back. You got cut off, kind of. Don, you got a question for Mrs. Edwards?
Yeah, pretty much more like a normal statement. First of all, let me say good morning to all. And wow, talking about the right person for the job. What a powerful presentation, the job function, the job responsibility. I thank you. I'm glad the governor chose you for that. No ifs, ands, buts about it. Your presentation on your speech, you didn't come with a hesitation. It was flawless to me. And that.
Call back, Don. I had to get, had to do some things here. Yeah. One more time. Shin? Okay. All right, let's go to Carlos. Brother Carlos?
Yeah, good morning, Ms. Edwards and the other panel. Appreciate you. Having worked in Baltimore in the insurance industry, Baltimore has had a historic problem with redlining and high insurance rates. Is the insurance administrator, is that administrator, does that have to be confirmed by the...
It is a lot.
Hello?
Go ahead.
Does the insurance administrator have to be confirmed by the Senate? And is the governor, in your knowledge, addressing any of the... Hello?
Hold on for Carlos. Ms. Edwards, are you with us? Ms. Edwards. It's not coming in. Hold on for a minute, Carlos. We're trying to get. She can hear us. Okay. She can hear us, but she can't talk. But okay. Ms. Edwards?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead, Carlos.
I don't know whether you caught my earlier conversation, but as I say, I worked in the insurance industry in Baltimore for a number of years, and Baltimore has had a historic problem with higher insurance rates and so-called redlining. Is the insurance administrator, which is appointed by the governor, do they have to go through a confirmation process with the Senate? And do you know whether the Governor Moore has any commission appointed to look into, investigate the higher inordinate insurance rates and redlining in Baltimore?
Thank you so much for commenting on that. You're 100% right. The Maryland Insurance Administration and that administrator does require Senate confirmation. And we do have a current administrator, Kathleen Barain, who is running the Maryland Insurance Administration. She will need to be Senate confirmed for our administration, which would happen in January. So the first answer to your question is yes, that the Maryland Insurance Administrator must be Senate confirmed. So that's 100% right. And you are also 100% right that we are all aware of the redlining and excessive insurance rates in Baltimore City. It's an issue on the car insurance, your property insurance. I'm a Baltimore City resident, so I feel it and see it, and I'm experiencing it firsthand. And this is an issue that, from a policy perspective, that we need to do a much better job at. And I'm really, really hopeful that during our administration, we can get to the root cause that we can reform some of our policies and that we can work with our partners in the insurance industry, because they've got to be at the table to help right these historical wrongs. I think you probably have seen, since you've been since you're in the industry, we're going through a case now with Erie Insurance related to some redlining. That case is still under review and in litigation, but it is a case where there are some very concerning allegations. And our administration is really doing everything that we can to ensure that there is fairness in our industry, in the insurance industry in the state of Maryland.
Okay, let's go to Smitty. Don, if you could call back quickly before we go into the second hour, you were cut off by mistake. Smitty, you're on air. You have a question for Ms. Edwards.
Yes, thanks for taking my call. Mm-hmm. I just want to say to Ms. Edwards, I appreciate what she's telling us. But one of the things I got the pleasure to serve on a board, the boards that I served on was paid. But the board does have limitation of time. It depends on if the governor has two sessions. You only serve for the two sessions that the governor is in place. But the department that I was sent to, we could stay there. But I was going back to what Bob Dashiell said. At the age of 70, when a person reached its 70, you had to give that position up. And the purpose of giving that position up when you reach the age of 70 is because other people are waiting to get on that board that has to be appointed. If someone sets on that board until they're 90 years old, it gives nobody else the opportunity to enjoy the benefit of that there. So I do hope that rule never be put in place, because I would have never been able to gotten the opportunity to step on a board, because when Reagan came in, he moved the age of retirement that you didn't have to retire at 70. But on the boards, you still got to go out there at 70 years old. So it's no, you can't come back in at a later age of 80. And there's no need for it.
Mr. Smitty.
70, you need a vacation. That's what I can tell you.
Mr. Smitty. Yes, just ma'am. Based out of curiosity, what would you think if the age changed, but you had quote unquote term limits where you can serve for two terms? That way that you won't have someone sitting on there for their entire life. You still have new people coming in and out. But still, if someone doesn't reach their peak capacity where they can serve in that function till 70, you know, they still have the opportunity.
Well, I think it would be a golden opportunity for us to send some of us home at the age of 70. That's the way I say it, Ms. Amar, because a lot of times we just don't have it. I mean, my friend gets up every day to go to work, and she's 74 years old, and I can see the wear and tear in her. And I think that we need to take a break. If we hadn't built our next age, what we've done by the age we reach 70, we might as well just forget it.
Let's go to Don, who's called back. Don, you're on air.
Yeah, real quickly. Good morning. I'll give it a say again. Good morning to all. And I want to say this. Wow. What a powerful presentation of your job function, responsibilities. I'm glad the governor chose you for that role, because you make us proud. And keep on doing the good work that you're doing. No ifs, ands, buts about it. Your presentation was flawless. No hesitation, no nothing. I mean, to me, it came from the heart. No ifs, ands, buts about it. And thank you for coming on, giving a community information in regard to what the government is doing and the people here putting in positions. You have a nice one, you and your family.
Oh, thank you, Don. Appreciate
you. I'm going to send to my mother. She needs to hear it. She, I need to
Send to her. Ms. Edwards, before I ask you for your final thoughts, would you give that, I think it was
website
again, where people can, apply for those commissions and boards?
Absolutely. It's govappointments.maryland.gov, G-O-V. So govappointments, one word, .maryland.gov.
Is Maryland spelled out or is it M-D?
Yeah.
Maryland is spelled out. Thank you.
Okay. Final thought, and first of all, on behalf of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. and Al Show, with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob, and I call him the Dean Dashiell, and myself, Carlton Douglas. We certainly thank you for taking time out of your, and we know you got a busy schedule to be with us, and we just appreciate you, love you, and respect you. And final thoughts before we go into our second hour.
So first thing I want to say is that I just appreciate Governor Westmore having the foresight and understanding of the importance of this role and giving me this assignment. So I'm super, super excited about that. But the other thing I think it's important for your listeners to know, and this is what I get asked about a lot when you talk about the pushback, is we lead with excellence. Everybody that we appoint, yes, more women, yes, more black and brown people, yes, more people from across the state, but guess what? They're also qualified. And we lead with excellence. And so I really want folks to know that you can have equity and excellence. And with everything that has happened with that affirmative action case out of the Supreme Court, people think that when people of color are talking about equity, somehow we are also talking about lowering the bar. And that's fundamentally not true. I'm very proud of the appointments that we've made on behalf of Governor Moore. And I just want your listeners to know that there are so many people of color who have never been represented, who never got to be a part of the they, who were overlooked, and they were qualified. And I'm very serious about excellence. The governor is very serious about excellence. And so anybody that we appoint, not only do they represent the community, they are qualified in their experiences, their background, their lived experience. And I want to be clear, qualified does not mean necessarily a college degree, a law degree. It's they have the experience that is needed to inform these particular policies. And so I'm just very grateful for that opportunity.
Well, thank you so very much, and we all wish you the best.
Thanks,
in your
Tim.
Position.
Thank you for joining us.
We really
us today.
Appreciate you. And hang on in there.
Thanks, Tish. I'll talk to you later.
Thanks. Okay. All right. Don't touch that dial. We're getting ready to go into the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Senior Ed Al Show with co-host attorneys Tehma Smith-Wilson, attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton Douglas. We got a lot to talk about on that second hour. If you want to call in, it's 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. We'll be right back.
Just enough for the city.
Talk in the day. So-